Guys, welcome to Bored to Death. I feel like I was even overly excited.
Aren't you always, though?
For that.
No, I think you're good.
Have you guys seen the newest episode of The Boys?
No.
Okay, so I'm just going to assume, because most of the world has watched this show.
Do we need a spoiler alert this? Or
No, because I think it's the second to the last newest episode. Like, I watched their episodes up until a few weeks ago. And one thing that I kind of like about that, what like Amazon and Netflix have done, is they're kind of reverting back to traditional TV viewing.
Oh, I hate that about them.
It's sort of cool because it builds like a thing about seeing the next episode.
No, it's awful.
For normal people,
as an obsessive compulsive like adult with ADHD, it's tough for me to deal with as well.
I don't like it.
But for people like us who are just used to just.
But yeah, when you grew up like watching a show, like a big show like Friends or Grey's Anatomy or 90210, I'm giving probably some bad examples.
I mean, you had me at Friends.
Okay. But it kind of like harkens, there's some nostalgic properties.
Yeah.
Maybe they go along having to wait a little bit.
I'll agree with that. But for the most part, people are like, screw. Okay, like The Walking Dead. You know, I know people that would have
viewing parties. That is still the biggest show that I've never watched.
But really?
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, not into zombies, huh?
I've watched.
You like?
No, I just like, I was, I don't know. I got it.
Still on his
path. I realized it existed too late, I think. And then ever since then, like when I see them advertise new episodes on like Twitter and or some social media or something like that, I'm like, they're still going with this.
I
don't know where to go. Like that, and kudos to them, because I don't know like where, how far can you go with this story?
It's like Land Before Time, but in the opposite way.
It's hopeless. Like that's like shit happens. But it's still they're still making new episodes.
Yeah. I watched one episode of that and I realized that everyone else is so stupid and doing so much stupid stuff. I was like, I don't care if you die and get eaten by zombies. And then I stopped watching the show.
See, and that's the thing. You have to be invested. It's a Lord of the Rings. What's the one?
Game of Thrones.
That mess.
Also never saw that.
I admit. Okay, I watched the very first episode of The Walking Dead and the very first episode of Game of
Thrones. Right. You couldn't get invested.
Yeah, I couldn't.
No, yeah, see, I could get invested in The Walking Dead because I read the comics.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I'm a bit of a nerd. So when they said, and I like zombies. So when they came out with that, I was like, yes, you know.
So but women, then, we've established a couple things for you.
Here we go.
One, Chris is incredibly attractive.
Take our word for it.
Well endowed.
Obviously.
And and he can read.
Hey, that's your one per show.
All right.
All right.
So go back
off of last episode. I was joking around with Sandbag last night, and there were a bunch of people in the GSB giving a shit about the podcast. And I replied back to them, like, I'm a narcissist. I only listen to my own podcast. And I forgot where I was going.
Sandvig?
Sandvig, yes. God. This is pathetic.
It comes with
what age. Were we talking about?
Well,
let me finish my thought.
Okay.
So right. Neither one of you could get into The Walking Dead. Like I was saying, I read the comics, you know, I'm a bit of a horror nerd, whatever.
Yeah.
I tried to watch Game of Thrones, and, you know, I watched all the way up until, I think they call it The Red Wedding.
Uh-huh.
And, like, you could watch videos of people losing their mind about what was happening at The Red Wedding. And, you know, it was such an event. And I got to that point, and I was like, I guess I'm not invested. Done.
That was the end of
it. Well, because I think it's a different kind of nerd.
Yeah. I know. Definitely.
I think there's, I mean, we can't just like.
No, sci-fi.
Other social nerds. Groups, we can't like lump all nerds together. I mean, that would be just as.
Very bigoted.
Yeah, you have you have different subsets of.
Thank you.
Of nerds.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have your geeks, then you have your nerds.
Mm-hmm.
Fantasy, science fiction, you know, horror.
Like, if I could take a Sharpie and draw on Luke's wall, I could make a flow chart of complete geeks.
Oh yeah.
And it would take up from here. Who knows? Feet.
There's a lot of us.
Yards.
There's a lot of us. Yeah, so no, I can get that, but yeah. If you can't get invested in characters, you know, why care?
I agree.
So
we were talking about The Boys.
What was it about?
I want to say you were going to say something about dicks.
No.
I was. No. Wow. That's why we're such good friends.
Did we really go there? That was like a 15-minute
That's why
ring around the rosy to get back to him bringing up dicks.
That's why we're such good friends. One of the newest episodes... I don't know if you guys are watching The Boys.
Spoiler
I don't want
alert.
To throw a spoiler alert. This show's been on for like a couple of years. So.
Well, I haven't seen it.
You're not going to watch it.
Well, I saw the first season.
So what I'm about to say does not apply to you.
Okay, I won't listen.
Guys, the show's been around for a while. So fuck off. All right? It's what I'm about to tell you is going to be, you're going to watch the show and you're going to be just fine. Okay, there's a guy that comes along who's a superhero, and his superpower is he's got a dick that grows out to like anaconda type length.
What does he?
And it can attack people. And
can you imagine the sexual assault charges?
I don't know. It was fucking crazy. I was watching it last night. And I like, they're in, like, everyone's trapped in this room, and this thing breaks through the window, and it looks like a, I don't know, like a fucking...
Snake with a sweater?
Long snail, or, yeah.
Oh.
Because he was uncircumcised. So it looks like, I don't know, like an aardvark's nose, like, that, like, creeps through all this shit, and it wraps around one of the guy's necks, and, like, almost pulls him through. And then, like, somebody runs around... I know, and kills him from behind, and then they walk through the door. Obviously, the dick falls off.
All right, you're spoiling too much.
And people walk around, and they realize that it's his dick that was the culprit.
Maybe he just saved me. I don't know.
That
sounds like some.
Well, it wasn't disturbing enough, stop watching.
That sounds like some Japanese hentai stuff. Also, another. They're,
I mean,
nerds.
With what they've primed us with, it's got to be pretty fucking gross and weird get us to be like, I can't watch this
anymore. That's kind of true. We're distanced.
Hawks will probably send me that video at some point.
Yeah. Yeah. That's
and that's why I'm not on any of your chats.
It's 100% guaranteed.
So, we want to take a break and then come back?
Yeah, guys, we're going to take a break.
Before we...
look up our sponsors, Flex Living and FNX. They both have great products that they're offering. But more importantly, like, I'm glad we started talking about some stuff because I wanted to add some levity because a lot of the research that myself and Luke and Chris and I have been doing and kind of just sitting and thinking on is some pretty heavy stuff because what we're going to get into talking about is suicide, domestic violence, and things of that nature that have skyrocketed from already epidemic levels pre-COVID. To now, and this has kind of been something that I've wanted to go off
No, you're good. Go, please keep continue.
Going. Go off of and just talking to friends here in the United States as well as internationally and globally, because this isn't something what we're going to talk about and the problems we're going to talk about are not just unique to the United States. This is a global problem. And so we do this once in a while on Bored to Death. We get serious about a topic and that's what we're about to do.
Generally right after we talk about giant dicks.
Exactly. I believe statistically, as we're going to reference many statistics tonight.
That was good.
After referencing dicks, referencing something serious is generally well received. So, I don't know. I think I nailed it.
You really did. Okay, we're good?
You did. I'm impressed.
All right, we're good.
Hey guys, welcome back to Bored to Death. one thing I forgot to start with earlier in talking about giant mutant dicks was not that that.
Well, now we're getting that makes me thirsty.
But one thing I forgot to come back with was my love not of giant mutant dicks, but of thirst quenching water.
So much for that sponsorship.
We're so close. Is Topo Chico. Guys, when I think of stuff that is not giant mutant dicks, I think of Topo Chico.
Don't look at me. You're not expecting a response from me. Right. So
just open okay. That shit.
So, ladies and gentlemen, the sound of refreshment. That's what we've all been waiting for. Anyways.
Well, yeah.
Let's end the suspense and or torture.
I was gonna say we could end the podcast now. That's what that's all people care about.
Yeah. So. Right. God damn. Anyways. Delicious as usual.
Oh yeah.
Big surprise.
The final note of levity before it gets super depressing.
We love Topo Chico. Guys, as what we're gathered here today to do is there's been a huge uptick in domestic violence, suicide, depressive disorder, acute and chronic anxiety since COVID restrictions have started. Not many people are talking about it. This episode is inspired by a lot of friends I have that are experiencing tough things that I'm experiencing and, that I'm going to talk about. And a big thing with me is I always think that if you're not part of a solution, you're part of a problem. And I'm not necessarily going to navigate a way to an answer because I don't have necessarily a better way of dealing with this stuff. But I do have statistics. I do have information and I do have some pretty compelling evidence that the way we're dealing with this is not the best way and that there is a better way. And we keep on hearing, and I'm not putting the United States of America above anybody else. We keep on hearing from our leadership. And when I say leadership in quotes, I'm talking about our government and those that we've chosen to represent us. They always hammer down that as the United States, we are better than something. So the evidence I'm going to try to present today is that we are better than what we are right now as far as how we're dealing with this. The people we're compromising and the extraordinary complications that we are creating with COVID restrictions and social isolation as they stand currently. So hopefully that makes sense to you guys. I'm never going to speak for anybody, but I know from a position of privilege that I believe I come from. And I'm not putting words in anyone's mouth. I'm not labeling large groups or anything when I say this. I believe I come from a place of privilege as a white male in today's United States. I believe that. Whether or not you do, I don't care. That's your own business. But from the place I come from, I have access to communicate with a lot of people, and I've got some information that I can dispense on people's behalf that may or may not need me to speak for them. But I'm taking this opportunity to try to get a conversation started based on the information and the statistics that I have to possibly change how we're going about this and or get people the help that they need that have been incredibly compromised by...
Can I say something real quick?
Let me finish my thought.
Okay.
By the restrictions and, I guess, rule of play that have been established by our governor, our government... And I'm not just talking about the United States. I'm talking about a global problem, and a problem that a lot of you, I don't know, see economically going into the future. But the problem I'm talking about is a humanist problem. It's a problem with ourselves, a problem that's going to perpetuate and be exacerbated by our current situation. And but anyways, I guess with that, Chris, what?
Just not to add on, but to make a comment about what you were saying earlier, as far as the place of privilege you mm-hmm. feel you're coming from and this ability.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it's, you're saying that because you may feel like people may take it in a bad way that, mm-hmm. you know, you're bringing this information out. I don't think you should have to explain that because mm-hmm. this is something that, along with everything else that's been going on during, you know, 2020, this is something that's been happening way longer than that. Mm-hmm. And it makes people uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. And you're bringing something out of the light or out of the dark into the light. You know, you're mm-hmm. putting a spotlight on something that should be talked about that, you know, people should know about.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no need for you to try to explain your position. You know, they can mm-hmm. either take it for what it is and respect you for it, or they can kiss my black ass, whatever, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah.
But this is something that needs to be talked about. This is a discussion that needs to be had on all fronts, period. Mm-hmm. You know, because no one should have to live the way that some of the people we're going to be talking about are living, whether it's domestic, suicide, you know, whatever it is, mm-hmm. whatever pain that person's living in, no one should have to live like that.
Right. And that's and I appreciate you saying that. And you know, it might not have been necessary. I hate trying to speak for other people.
No, I get
but I realize a lot of people aren't in a position where anyone will listen to them.
Yeah, and it's not always speaking for someone else, like I said, it's just, it's bringing something out of the dark into the, because no one wants to talk about these things.
You know, no one is talking
about it. Yeah, no one wants to bring this stuff up mm-hmm. because it's sad. And no one wants to be sad.
Mm-hmm.
And so it gets ignored. And, you know, you have all these people out there, and I'm sure you have numbers for us, but you have mm-hmm. all these people out there dealing with things like this on a daily basis, and they may not see an end.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like, again, it's not about talking for them. It's about just speaking up, period. Yeah. So, and yeah, I know you like to play the diplomat, whereas I don't have to. So, again, whoever may not like it can kiss my leg ass.
And
what if we just wanted to anyhow?
And that's your one a day.
And again, that's Chris brings up an incredibly good point where let's put aside, and I'm glad he checked me there. Let's put aside where we think we're coming from as a point of privilege or whatnot, whatever word you want to use, and let's just get this stuff out in the open. Domestic violence and suicide were already at epidemic-like proportions. Just let me scroll through some of my notes here. 264 to 300 million individuals worldwide already live with depression. 284 to 300 million live with anxiety-related disorders. 46 to 60 million live with bipolar disorder. We have a population that, based on the last United States census, 25% or 1/4 of us live alone in an isolated instance. Social isolation as communicated by the CDC, Psychology Today, and areas of that nature have already gone into the depths of the problems that social isolation can cause. If we want to kind of put a microscope on the situation, we can look at what is solitary confinement do to a prisoner? What do those kind of things psychologically do to a person? And as what we're going to find out today is it's nothing good. It's detrimental. It has long-term effects. And these tactics that we're using, such as social isolation, quarantining, things of that nature, they've been used in the past and successfully. And I'm trying to come at this from an enlightened point of view and use science, reason, and humanism to try to make a compelling argument as to why we need to look deeper into this. And so that's what we're going to try to do. I rattled off some statistics. Those are pre-COVID. So if we want to go over the numbers again, I'm talking about 300 million people pre-COVID. Post-COVID, we can only and this, we're just talking about depression and anxiety. We're not even touching domestic disputes. We're not touching suicides, which mind you, I'll go into soldier suicide, which had already been at an epidemic rate prior to COVID. A lot of people are familiar with the 22 a day. That's 22 veterans kill themselves every day. Kill themselves every day. That's pre-COVID. Since COVID, over the last 5 to 7 months? Are we in month 7?
We're month 7 of the 15 days.
Okay, month 7. 20% increase. From Army leadership have supported a 20% increase in soldier suicide. Close to a 30% increase in active duty suicides. That was up from 88 to 114. We've taken, and I'll go back, and I want to make this as evident to you guys as possible. The WHO estimates if lockdowns continue into the next few months, they can expect a global increase of 31 million cases of gender-based violence. Globally, 87,000 women and girls lost their lives as victims of domestic or family violence. I'm not minimizing the deaths of COVID, but if we're taking 87,000 women and girls, and I've never been shy about the fact that I am pro-woman in this world. 87,000 women and girls who have lost their lives pre-COVID. I'll say it again. Pre-COVID. Lose their lives every year. And we're going into a situation, not going into, we're living in a situation where they are put in danger and endangered more and more every day. And another... some more stuff. Jean-Luc, I'm going to totally mess up his name.
He's French. It's okay.
Yeah. Jean-Luc Lamont or something. Very nice. United Nations Director of Policy and Analysis and Public Information on Drugs and Crime. In Italy alone, 31.5% of women ages 16 to 70 will experience physical and sexual violence. Domestic homicides occur in 0.4% of those cases. 35 of these will actually be reported to authorities. So keep in mind what I just said right there. 31.5% of all women ages 16 to 70 will experience, and this is just in Italy, will experience sexual violence and domestic homicides. That's grossly underreported. Italy, that's just an Italian example. We'll get into some numbers from the United States here shortly, but I'm just not going to focus on the United States because I feel like that's turning a blind eye to the rest of the world, which is experiencing just as much, if not more, of a problem than we are here. And why am I doing this, you might ask? Well, I'll tell you why. Because we've created a mess. We've taken groups that were already disproportionately affected by just the way we live in the world. I'm talking about the elderly, African Americans, Hispanics, that particularly here in the United States, single mothers, women. We've made things catastrophically worse for them. We've taken these demographics of Americans, and not just America, here in America, but globally. These groups that have been most susceptible to COVID-19. We know who those groups are. It's the elderly. It's in low percentages, young adults, other Americans. And again, I'm not minimizing that. So don't twist my words. I'm not minimizing that. Every life matters. And that's why I'm talking about this. Because every life matters. those who are the least susceptible to COVID, these young adults. The CDC reports that there's been a 40% increase in depressive disorder, anxiety disorder, a 30% increase in suicides. The WHO again, like I said, estimated 31 million cases of gender-based violence if COVID continues for the next few months. If we just take those estimates at a 0.4% mortality rate of those that end up in murders, it's a tough thing to go through. I'm 57.8 million Americans have mental or substance abuse disorders. That's Americans across the country. 57.8 million. 31 million. Like, we can keep adding up these numbers. And why are they being ignored? They were safe. They were safe. The CDC reports that the biggest group of these people that are susceptible to suicide, social anxiety, and depression are those 18 to 24. Those, they were, in past tense, they were the safest group pre-COVID. And even post-COVID, they were the safest group. They're the ones that said, you guys, based on the statistics that we have, based on the information that we have, you guys are safe. We put them in danger. Because now they're the biggest group that is experiencing suicidal ideations and thoughts, depression, anxiety. And I haven't even gotten into domestic violence. Those that were safe and were, I'm using past tense, those that were safe are now in danger. We have flattened one curve just to create another one and another one. And another one. And we had the information that stated exactly that. We knew going into this is what would be created. Because we had studies in the past. There's a direct link that's been correlated between natural disasters and epidemics throughout history, where there has been a massive increase in domestic violence, in suicides, in divorces, as Chris and I talked about offline, sexual abuse. We knew what all these did. And then not only did we know about what all these did, but in 2014, we had a massive study commissioned by the CDC, WHO, and the United Nations on the most recent Ebola outbreak. Let me bring up my notes again here really quick. The most recent Ebola outbreak in multiple African countries, where they stated specifically, this study was commissioned specifically because abuse against women, children, and economics were massively affected by the social restrictions that were put on during that epidemic. And so we know all this stuff. We knew this going into it. We know there's a trend. So with these restrictions, if we're flattening one curve just to create another, in the grand scheme of things, what help are we really doing? And I know, I'm not denying science. I'm not denying science. I know in the 1918 flu epidemic, yellow fever, poliomyelitis, I know in these prior epidemics, social distancing and mask wearing and even contact tracing and up to HIV as well in the 80s was used in Ebola incredibly effectively. But at what cost? Some of them, they work. We know that. But the social distancing protocols and the isolation protocols, we know what they're doing to people, and it's dangerous. In a 2018 survey by Cigna, one of the largest insurance companies in the United States, 20,000 American adults were surveyed. And this, again, 2018, so way pre-COVID. Over one half of the adults reported sometimes or always feeling alone, sometimes always feeling their relationships are not meaningful, and sometimes or always reported they felt isolated. That's pre-COVID. So a 20,000. So as a control group, sure, you can go 20,000 people, half of 20,000 people. What can we really make of that? Well, that's kind of how we work science, is we set up control groups and we set up controls, and we try to make predictions based off populations. If you want to scoff at those numbers, that's the same methods that are used, our government has used to put these restrictions on us. They're population studies. So if you're going to scoff at one, I would question why you scoffed at the other. And the thing that would come to mind would be that those numbers don't serve your purpose. But these serve mine, so I'm going to talk about them. Julianne Holt Lundstedt, a PhD from Brigham Young University, published in Perspectives in Psychology and Neuroscience. A lack of social connection heightens health risks as much as alcohol use disorder or smoking 15 cigarettes a day is twice as harmful as physical and mental health. Twice as harmful to physical and mental health as obesity. The latest U.S. Census, I believe I mentioned this earlier, a quarter of our population lives alone. That's the highest in the recorded history since the census began. If you're alone and are already pseudo-isolated, as the progression goes, when you get into a depressive state, you don't realize it. A lot of times it's your friends that see it first. It's your family that sees it first, that you're not acting normal. You're not acting, I hate to say quote unquote right, but you're acting aberrant based on an established mode of behavior that you've had your entire life. You're the last person to always notice that. If you have nobody around to give you feedback, and a lot of people will say this, and I'm trying to just prepare for it. Well, what about social media interactions or Zoom or stuff like that? Are you telling me that social media, which is the
fakest,
the most fake, the biggest proprietor of narcissism and bullshit out there, that is responsible for more online bullying and making people who are already depressed feel even worse as a basis for a defense against isolation? Then, man, I was about to say you're part of the problem. I'll just correct myself and say you are the problem.
social media does not bring us closer together. Like there's a reason why a lot of applications and why companies like Apple and Samsung started adding screen time monitors onto their devices, because those corporations that make billions off of us, they realize it's a problem. And you have companies like Facebook that are trying to get into some legal tussle with Apple about that, saying they're trying to inhibit their business. It's insane. So there's... I've thrown a lot of stuff out there. And I've got a lot more. And granted, I wish I'd gone over my notes a few more times so this would come out as more of a... in more of, I guess, a linear fashion and seem to be more organized. But, like, we've created a mess, guys. And there's... and like I said earlier, there's better... the methods we're using are effective. Success leaves clues. We've gotten through past epidemics. We've gotten through past natural disasters and things of that nature. But up until the last few decades, we never had the data of the collateral damage of how we dealt with those. We never had data about the groups that we compromised. So you want to... so I'll say this. If you're into social justice, if you're into equality of opportunity, equality of outcome, even, let me tell you who's most affected by these restrictions. The greatest number of minimum wage job holders are women, blacks, and Hispanics. So you want to say you're into social reform and social justice, and these restrictions are disproportionately affecting those three groups, then these restrictions are racist and bigoted and sexist. Because based off how we make our other arguments, these fit the exact same bills. I will say that again. These restrictions are bigoted, racist, and sexist because they disproportionately affect certain groups. And I'll take that even further. I got into a deep discussion with some other people about, well, there's grassroots programs that help alleviate this from... you know, going out, making sure people get the things that they need, that the people are socializing, things like that. Well, access has been extremely limited and or completely taken away. Why has our voting system been completely under fire over the last 4 to 5 years? And what I lost count of the number of lawsuits that have been filed by different political groups saying the same thing. And their number one argument is a lack of access or a prohibited access. It's the same for some of the Supreme Court cases that have been brought against, you know, Second Amendment laws. And why... in those cases, people have won because they've limited people's access and or ability to exercise their basic rights. So tell me how these restrictions are constitutional if they're compromising the access people have to get help. Because those same groups... women, African Americans, and Hispanics that are also the highest and most susceptible to domestic violence. When shelters have a limited number of people they can go to because of social restrictions, now they can take about a third to a quarter of the victims and or families. And I don't mean to leave men out. and because men are and have been and will continue to be victims of all these things as well. But I'm trying to focus on the biggest groups. So tell me what those people are supposed to do. We've had cities like Chicago that have added $1.3 million into their budget to pay for hotel rooms for some of these victims of domestic violence as a way to escape. In a major metropolitan area like Chicago, in a small rural area where I reside, $1.3 million dries up like that. If you think that's a fix to anything, that's a Band-Aid at best. Things that are compounding this problem. And I don't want to... I'm not going to get into a political war here. But I'm going to hammer on my president. I'm going to hammer on my state's governor. And some other politicians. It gave me some hope at the debates when our president, and it was tough to catch because it was in the melee of words that if you were lucky or unlucky enough to have watched our presidential debates, which I'm sure if you lived anywhere other than the United States were very enjoyable. But when you're stuck in the country that both those guys, you know, may possibly represent. That's a different story. Yeah. Our president made a comment to his opposition for the presidential election, Joe Biden, about people that are oppressed, the massive amounts of suicides coming from these restrictions. And he's right. Joe Biden's campaign did not necessarily have a retort at that comment, but I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt because there was a lot of bullshit going on there. But anyways, our president made that comment. He's made that comment in the past. But just recently, and I know there's other factors that are involved, but just recently when he made the order to call off negotiations between a second stimulus plan, if we looked at the first stimulus plan and we see the $50+ million that was earmarked for specifically for domestic violence victims, we can only assume based on the amount of the stimulus, the first stimulus package, that in the second one, there would be at least as much money earmarked for them. When he broke off negotiations, again, I'm sure there's several factors for that. And I don't know any facts having to do with that, so I'm not going to condemn anyone. I'm not going to point any fingers. But by doing that, he turned his back on some of the most vulnerable groups that are out there. And in watching our gubernatorial debates last night, it became incredibly evident that our own governor, Jay Inslee, is doing the same thing Donald Trump is doing, talking out of both sides of his mouth, bringing up points about how people are compromised, susceptible, vulnerable, but then doing nothing about it, except for, you know, some great and elaborate, you know, ballet of words that's one of the things that infuriates me the most about politicians is how they speak out of both sides of their mouth. And but it's disheartening because none of them
None of them are really doing anything about it. And this is, and so that's why we're trying to talk about it here on Bored to Death. Because it's, these things were already at epidemic levels. They were at epidemic levels prior to COVID. Domestic violence, numbers are insane.
It's scary. You can see it.
It is scary. It's, and I'm trying to go through these. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, intimate partner violence includes victimization of a current former spouse, current former dating partners. Violence can include sexual, emotional, and economic abuse, according to the Department of Justice. Worldwide, 35% of women have experienced either physical and or sexual intimate partner violence or non-partner violence, according to the United Nations. 35%. Can anyone jump on something and see the percentage of Americans that have been affected with COVID?
Caught it or seriously caught it or died or
what? Anything. Give me like the highest numbers. The highest numbers.
Only 200,000 have died, so that's not a lot.
Well, it's only 200.
It's in the millions. I mean,
I believe 2 million worldwide. 2 million worldwide.
But there's the numbers don't compare. Period. Mm-hmm. I mean, and like the points you're making are very good. They're very strong. And again, like I said, it's freaking scary. But also on top of that, we're talking. Suicide, we're talking domestic violence. Those numbers are huge. You know where we haven't even been, where the numbers mm-hmm. would probably just be insurmountable? Child abuse, drug and alcohol use. Mm-hmm. You know,
what they say about liquor sales, they went up like 375%.
It's
1%.
Because that was an essential item that people needed.
You can't
close the liquor stores or the weed dispensaries.
Oh, I'm well aware.
But, everything else, the local restaurant that, they're running on fumes as it is, let's close them.
It's 1%. So, let's see here.
And that's
less than 1%. Nearly one out of every 100 Americans has tested positive for COVID.
Okay, so if we're just going...
Which doesn't mean they ever even had symptoms. That's like the most you could ever possibly imagine.
Okay, so if we're going off of, let's say we just go off of Italy. Randomly, I just have those statistics in front of me. 31.5% of women. So 31.5 out of 1,000, I believe is what that is. Or
31%?
31.5%.
That's
31.5 out of 1,000 or something, right?
That's 31.5 out of 100.
Or 100. Right. So 31.5% of women are going through this. 0.4% of those cases are going to end up as domestic homicides. So maybe we can just jump on a calculator. What are we at?
I'll be honest, I probably couldn't find an accurate number.
31.5 people. Mm-hmm. And what was the other
0.4% of those are going to end up in domestic homicides. Yeah. And that's just in Italy.
Right.
That's 0.4%.
Mm-hmm.
Of 31.5.
Well, when you do it out of 31 people, it's not a lot. But if you did it out of a population, it'd be a pretty substantial number.
We're multiplying that.
What is that?
Yeah, it's 0.4%.
Of 31. Out of 31. How many...
.126. Yeah, out of 31.
Yeah, 31 times every country. I mean, if we're looking at that as a base model.
So that's 1 out of 100 people.
1 in 100, which I think is greater.
Out of 300 million people, it's 37,000 people.
Yeah.
To be very American-centric.
I mean, okay. No, it's just because... I just saw a bunch of numbers coming out because, you know, mm-hmm. they're talking about opening up high school sports and whatnot, and what the numbers had to be to be able to allow sports to play, you know,
right,
how
right,
many
right.
how many infections out of the population, you know, and it's like, yo, the numbers you just gave me were higher and more acceptable than the numbers that are to play a high school football game.
Right.
So it's like, go figure, right?
Dude, it's never made any sense.
Yeah.
Not from day one.
It's incredibly inconsistent. And I wanted to throw a bunch of stats at people just to magnify the problem. And I'm even kind of doubting myself whether I did a good enough job of that. Neha Gill from APNA, Domestic Violence and Gender-Based Crimes, states these are already at pandemic levels for domestic violence. And again, we're just talking at domestic violence. We have some of these numbers didn't transfer over.
So let me get this straight.
Mm-hmm.
You keep looking for what you're looking for, but we were at epidemic level or pandemic levels in domestic violence before the whole COVID thing started.
Right.
Is that what I'm understanding?
Mm-hmm.
And now that we, so many places were under, some more strict than others, but still under restrictions, that those numbers have jumped astronomically. Mm-hmm. Is that what I'm understanding as well? And that we're just talking domestic violence. We're not talking about everything else that may have came of that. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that we can all agree, you know, at this table right here, that the numbers are pretty fucking big, period.
Yeah.
Okay. That's all I wanted to get out there.
Okay. And again, those were what we just had hammered on was domestic violence. And here's some other statistics. This is from CDC.gov. Symptoms of anxiety and depressive disorder increased considerably in the United States during April to June of 2020 compared to the same period of 2019. To assess mental health, substance use, and suicidal ideation during the pandemic, representative panel surveys were conducted among adults 18 years across the age. Greater than 18 years of age across the United States. Overall, 40.9% of respondents reported at least one adverse mental or behavioral health condition, including symptoms of anxiety disorder or depressive disorder, 30.9% symptoms of trauma and stressor-related disorder related to the pandemic, 26.3% having started to increase substance use to cope with the stress of emotions related to COVID-19. 13.3% of respondents who reported having seriously considered suicide in the last 30 days before completing the survey. 10.7% was significantly higher among respondents aged 18 to 24. 25.5% of those were minority racial ethnic groups. Hispanic respondents, 18.6. Non-Hispanic Black respondents, 15.1. Unpaid caregivers, 30.7. And that triggers my memory. And again, when I made the statement that these restrictions are not only racist and sexist, besides being in the majority of minimum wage earners that are most affected by this group, women also make up the majority of frontline healthcare workers and what classifies as unpaid caregivers. Now again, if you're pro-woman and these restrictions are putting women in more danger and giving them less support than they may otherwise receive, again, what, like, what's the, what are we getting out of this by creating the way we're dealing this, what, like, when we're endangering other people, when we're compromising other groups that are already compromised, I don't understand. And it's, and I'm talking about it because nobody is, or at least nobody, hardly anybody in the United States is. There's when I did a massive search on YouTube for these things and on the internet, I found some German TV stations, some Australian TV stations, which Australia, I'll just say this, shame on you for how you've locked in your own residents and almost made them prisoners in their own homes.
Almost.
The can't leave in the state of Victoria. You can't go more than 5 kilometers away from your house. There's a 7 p.m. curfew.
COVID only comes out at night.
Are they wearing ankle monitors? Because they might as well.
And they're levying $1,650 tickets to people that violate these rules. And mind you, these are people that they won't let work either.
No. You know.
So, but, and then one of the number one groups of people that are affected are hospitality workers and sex workers, which you can go to Home Depot to get something, but you can't go get a lap dance. Like, or, okay, that's a little close contact.
I was about to say.
You can't even, okay.
Wait, no, I'm on board, though.
You can't even go. But it's... Or just go to a restaurant
or a strip joint.
Or go to a bar and grab a drink.
It's
like,
the same argument
I think
had.
That's fair. I think the bar and get a drink is a better analogy.
But no, it's the same argument I had. You have kids that can't go to school, but you can fill up this airplane, you know, with all these people. They're wearing masks, so mm-hmm. it's safe. You know, they're breathing each other's air, but that's safe. But these kids can't go to school, you know.
So that's been the biggest thing about it for anybody who doesn't just eat up information and just spit it out without thinking about it is, I mean, that's been the big rub is the restrictions don't make sense. Yeah. If they made sense, it wouldn't be a problem, but they don't make sense. So anybody who thinks about things on a deeper level than this is what was given to me, so it must be true, starts looking at it and going like, wait, so does social distancing work? Because if it works, then we're good. We just have, it's only 6 feet. That's not hard. I don't really like being closer than 6 feet to strangers anyhow. So, and if that doesn't work, then masks work, then we're still good. And if both those don't work, then we're fucked anyhow. And I want to go back because I did say only 200,000. And it's because I'm insanely logical and it's probably borderline sociopathic. I had a great aunt die from COVID.
Mm-hmm.
Incredibly tragic. Way more tragic than it had to be because they wouldn't let her see anybody while she was diagnosed with COVID until she was in hospice care. And then all of a sudden it was okay because COVID doesn't live after hospice care. Obviously not true.
And again, the elderly, which our governor in his debate last night went on to emphatically talk about how important of a group they are. And they are.
Of course they are.
Every life matters. I'm not. And when I say that, like, guys, don't lump me into that. Like, which I know a lot of people lump it like, oh, you're one of those all lives matter guys.
Oh God.
This isn't about that. This is about, yes, I agree that elderly lives matter as well. But I'm going to make a strong fucking statement here.
Uh-oh.
You talk to any elderly person. You talk to myself. I'm 41. If you give me the opportunity, and nearly every elderly person in this country, and I can imagine it goes globally, if they could give their lives so a young person could have and experiences or freedoms or something like that, I'm gonna make a bold statement and say the majority of them would say, yeah, I've lived, because I've had a lot of relatives that have died, you know, of dementia, different diseases. And as they got there, one of the most common themes is better me than you.
Yep.
Like I lived a life. Yeah. And I'm sitting here at 40, and granted, I'm not going to say everyone should be like me. I'm sitting here at 41 and say,
I would endanger myself. So these young people, these groups, 18 to 24, that were safe, that were safe, again, that were safe prior to COVID, that we've now put in situations where they should be the most, some of the most social that they'll ever be in their lives. And we've taken that opportunity away from them, which has so much to do with human development, creativity, you know, the, you name it. Their
social development.
Yeah, yeah. I
as a homeschooler, I can relate to that.
And I don't think, and I don't think I'm alone. And I don't, I granted, I don't want it to come to that. But if it did, sit down and talk with an older person.
Yeah,
I like it. The majority of the ones I've talked to are like, yeah, like if it came between you and me, yeah, I'll court.
I've heard a guy say, I've had a good life. I'm okay. Straight up. I had a good life.
Mm-hmm.
I'm okay.
Both my grandmas died at that point. They were like, I'm good. Yeah. It's like, they didn't die for another 10 years, but 10 years earlier, they were like, I don't care.
Well, and it comes to inequality. One thing we all want for each other, I don't care what side of the aisle you are, we all want an equality of opportunity. This way of living, this way of restricting human beings is taking away inequality of opportunity. You can make the argument like, oh, it's making everybody equal. We're all staying home. Bullshit. Yeah. Because this affects different people in vastly different ways. And it affects different demographics in vastly different ways. So if that's your answer, shame on you.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm going to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
I had a discussion with somebody a couple years back. A lot of stuff, heavy stuff was happening. And they were like, so where's the scariest place you've ever been?
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, along with my thoughts. You know,
mm-hmm.
But throughout this whole situation, I'm essential. You know, I'm an essential worker. I get to interact with people, you know. That's keeping me from being alone with my thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you remember what it was like to be 18, 19, 20.
Yeah.
Where you're no, he doesn't. It was a very long time ago.
It was quite a long time
ago. Yeah, but he's quite immature, so.
Yeah.
But no, like, how susceptible are you to certain thoughts, certain acts? You know, if you get it in your mind and you're allowed to sit on it for a while, you know, you're going to run with it.
Yeah, your own mind is one of the most dangerous places that you can reside in. And when you're socially isolated, that's the only place you can live.
Yeah.
And there, in a,
should we take
I want to kind of, yeah, I think we should take a break because I kind of want to move on to, I've gotten a lot of shit out of my system. Granted, a lot of this is emotionally driven and I'm upset because in the week or 2 weeks doing the research and leading up to this, and again, part of the upset is I'm not sure if I'm delivering what I wanted to as well as I could have, but shit happens.
I think you did a great job.
I don't want to just hammer on how shitty stuff is and who's having a tough time, because that wouldn't go along with the statement I made at the very beginning of this podcast, is that if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. And so when we come back from this break, we're going to take a turn and we're going to start talking about what we can do to help now that we know how big of a problem it is, how we know that people are struggling. And again, not just here in the United States, but globally, because that's where it starts. It starts with the conversation. And you guys listening, you people out there have to make it important to yourselves.
I mentioned it in a social media post a little while back on International Rhino Day. You've got to just, at some point, you've got to just choose one thing and be a fucking champion for that. And these people that are struggling, these compromised groups, they're worth you being a fucking champion for. So we'll come back shortly. Hey guys, welcome back to Bored to Death. There's a lot of stuff that we went through on the first segment of that episode, and I'm kind of processing a lot of it too. I'm kind of sitting here having a cathartic moment that I took in a shit ton of information over the last week and a half or so, trying to prep for this episode and sort of word barfed it.
I thought you did great.
Onto the microphone. But Luke, you had some things you wanted to say. The conch is yours.
I wanted to clarify. I feel so terrible. Mm. When you asked me that question, just how I responded to it was like, in relation to all these numbers, to me, 200,000 people didn't seem as significant as it would related to zero deaths, right? Like that, it's all perspective.
It's an easy slip, I didn't fault you for it.
And it's not that I haven't been affected. Like I said, my great aunt, sweetest lady ever, totally bald when she died.
Mm-hmm.
But when people look at that 200,000 number, they don't realize that 100,000 people every year die of the flu. Or 80,000 or 70,000, whatever. Like 70,000 is not a big deal. But no one cares. And that's the weirdest thing to me, because I view a death as a death. I don't, I do kind of discriminate upon age. Like I do think it's more tragic when someone who potentially had more years left.
And that's naturally. And that's natural because it's opportunities missed.
Allegedly, right? As if we're guaranteed an average lifespan, which we're not. So that's where that came from, is just my mindset as far as, when you look at the collateral damage, I'm not sure at this point, and we won't know for probably years, I'm not sure we saved a single life net.
Yeah, and thank you for bringing that up about the net end value of how...
Because that's what we're talking about, right? Like, if a death is a death, so you saved someone from dying of this, but then in turn they die of this... Or they lived, but then this person over here died. How much is that worth? Was it a?
And I think you're just trading lives. And unsuccessfully tried to communicate that.
It was perfect.
Earlier, the flattening one curve just to make another.
Yeah, like exactly that.
Or not, or just throwing a pebble in a pond and creating a ripple. So it looks like it's going down, but something else is going up. That's what I think we're doing.
We'll know here in a couple of years, probably, when the numbers come out.
And you know, the German head of the WHO estimates that as well. They think there's going to be a 40% increase globally in suicides across the United States over the next 6 years, based off what is going on right now with COVID, and that's depression, bankruptcies, you know, joblessness, you know, all the things that go along with the economics of that. And again, at the beginning of this episode, I promised not to try to hammer on the politics of this. To a varying degree of success, I think I did. But to the stuff that I didn't, you can politicize yourself. So that's the World Health Organization. That's one of the organizations we leaned on the most going through this whole COVID thing. So if we were going to believe the things they said about this or that and how we should plan on and fight, and things we should implement to mitigate COVID,
if we were taking a lot of those, that information from the WHO to implement the programs we have now, then wouldn't it seem logical that these other numbers that the WHO is putting out, we should take as well? Because we can't just like put information in a fucking gold sifter and just look for what fucking we have that what we want. You know, look for the gold that remains.
I want to reaffirm my confirmation bias.
Right, exactly. And that's what that's what a big thing that's going on here is confirmation bias. So if the WHO estimates that a 40% increase in suicides, let me tell you guys something. About one person in 5,000 dies by suicide every year, with an estimated global rate of 10.5 per 10,000. And that's down from 11.6 in 2008. So, close to 800,000 people die a year by suicide, which is one person every 40 seconds.
And that number is going to go up by 40%?
According to the World Health Organization. One person every... Guys, that's just worth repeating. One person every 40 seconds pre-COVID kills themselves. That's a hopelessness that someone carries around with them for a period of time when things are quote unquote going well. Just think about that for a second. Any of the stuff like I said in the first half of the episode that you don't want to dispute or get pissed about or something. You know, I don't care. I'm just trying to start a conversation about it, because the whole point of this is I didn't think anybody else was. And I've talked to a lot of people and they're not doing well. They're not doing well. And the major media contributors that we depend on, CNN, ABC, NBC, Fox News, everyone's favorite news outlet, Facebook.
I prefer Instagram.
Fuck you, Facebook. Just go fuck yourself. You are such a shitstorm of...
never getting this sponsorship.
You are such a shitstorm... of
good
just bullshit. Like if I have ever seen a more divisive way of communication, and my vocabulary is not good enough to talk about what a fucked up institution you are, Facebook. So I will move on.
Well said.
But so we have those things as suicides, and I stated when we were ending, at least I think I remember stating, we're going to start talking about a solution. I stated we spent the first hour plus talking about the problem. And what I stated briefly in the first segment, which you guys might have gone over, is that I truly do believe if you're not part of the solution, you are part of the problem. So I will freely admit, I don't have a solution. However, I do have a lot of information. I do have a lot of statistics. And to those of you out there, you pessimists that are sitting out there saying, well, oh, you can use statistics to manipulate anything you want. True. However, as a beneficiary of science, as a believer of science, as someone that wanted to be a doctor, quote/scientist himself at one period, I have a great respect
for it. And science is based off quantifiable data. So at some point, all of you out there that want to question statistics have to sit down and be acceptable of at least something from somewhere to create a belief system. So you can comb the internet, you can question all the statistics you want until you find some that align with your belief system. And if you're that guy, congratulations.
Unless you're a nihilist.
Yeah.
I'm a nihilist, Lebowski.
Yeah, I believe in nothing.
How many of those do we have out there? Is there anyone?
Well, then we have that whole episode on being, what is it, stoic?
Yeah. Not quite nihilist.
And stoicism.
But equally
and,
impersonal.
And going into, like, how do we deal with this? Because I don't want to get off the topic too much.
I do want to hear a solution.
How we deal with this? A stoic approach is... I think a stoic approach seems to be gaining popularity. A stoic approach was gaining popularity with the climate of our world pre-COVID. I think we had an episode with people like Ryan Holiday. I'm forgetting a few of their other names who have a large stoic base on the books they've authored. Tim Ferriss, excuse me, is his name. So a stoic way of dealing with these things was gaining popularity to begin with. But does that... A stoic way of dealing things, that deals with the individual. It doesn't necessarily help the guy on the street that you are having a stoic belief about. Because based on this conversation, that guy, socially break up groups that much, that guy or your neighbor or your roommate could be the next person that takes that step of using a permanent solution to a temporary problem to end their life. There are good and bad ways to go about helping someone out that's having these problems. I want to talk about some things I use, and the ridiculousness of it is kind of funny, but or at least to me it is. So you should find some, if the person going through it can find some amusement in it, you should as well, I think.
I find amusement out of all of your problems, Evan.
As a lot of you know, because I've been vocal about it, I did some stuff and got as a consequence of those things, I got into a program with my work and with another institution that has, you know, prevented me from drinking. And one of the things that I've been going with, and I talked with my I have a life coach, for those of you that don't know. And again, that is a luxury to be able to pay somebody to work you through simple life tasks. But one of the things that I was struggling with as talking with my coach was I already have a tendency to withdraw at times. And one of the social things that I did when I was publicly drinking and going out and things like that was I would just go to a bar to be around people and just have a few drinks and then go home.
It's like a coffee shop, but for adults.
Exactly. Yeah.
And that's a good way of putting it. It doesn't make it seem as bad.
I was about to say that doesn't sound horrible. You're a single person.
Yeah, I know.
What's worse, drinking at home or going out?
Right, and quarantine
stopped me drinking at home.
You're making
way
me
worse.
Feel bad about like myself now.
A single dude that you know is doing pretty good in a lot of aspects in his life, but that was one of my things that I like to do, and. I couldn't do that anymore. And that was a big part of my social life was just as weird as that sounds was just sitting and people watching in bars and having some drinks.
You want to know what sounds that not to cut you off, but you know what sounds weird is that I was working up to do that before all of this happened. I've never gone out to a bar by myself, dinner, a movie, anything.
You were just about to do it? Well, I didn't
and
do it until I got divorced.
I was telling myself, 2020, I'm going to do these things by myself. Yeah. I'm going to get out there and be more social. And 2020 said,
meet people.
Ha!
Fuck you.
Yep. But no, so please continue.
Okay. And So, like I said, that was a big part of my social life. And I was talking to my coach about that. And there's some other things I was going through as well. I had some injuries when I served in the military that have some lingering effects and stuff like that. They're better and worse at some times. And we were talking and I was like, I know this sounds really, I think the word I used was pathetic and he corrected me. Was pathetic, but I'm an essential worker. I go out and I get to see my best friends every day that I work because I do. And two of them are sitting right with me right now, which is, again, something I'm incredibly thankful for. But that I didn't realize how big of an aspect of my life that was just being able to go to someplace simple, like a bar or a dive bar. And sitting there, just being able to sit in my own thoughts around other people. And the fact that that was gone was really fucking with me to the point where I was staying up incredibly late. I couldn't sleep. When I did sleep, my anxiety was getting worse. And a lot of it just had to do with this simple thing that my social structure that I had was minorly affected. And granted, it wasn't in particular. This was back in December, January when this started, and COVID, I think officially in the United States was like February, March ish.
It's been so long, I don't
remember.
Okay,
yeah, and. So just taking that experience of myself of kind of based on my lifestyle prior to quote unquote socially distance myself from what I was doing before. And then now seeing the rest of the population have to do that. Like, I don't care if there's other outlets. Like if you can like, you've got Zoom, you got Facebook, even if you are an essential and have been an essential employee and get to go to work every day and stuff like that, your life's altered. And that's tough. And a lot of us get like, if you're like me, I deal with, ADHD really bad. I'm somewhat compulsive. You get married to a fucking routine, man. Like you get married to it. And when your routine gets mixed up a little bit, it has some ripple effects. And I'm not the only one out there that's like this. I know there's a lot of us out there that are like this, especially now in a world that has become that, you know, from social media and stuff like that was supposed to bring us all together, that has subsequently actually divided us more, has pushed us into ourselves more than we ever have been. So I know there's some of you out there, a large number of you out there that are like me. That like you got your fucking thing and like you think
you're good on your own and you got this and stuff like that. And maybe you do. I'm not here to say that you don't. But there's some things that no matter what you think about it, interaction gives you. And everybody likes positive feedback. Like you know, and I'm not talking about positive feedback like a like or a fucking follow on, you know, Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook or something like that. I'm talking about like actual positive feedback, in person. And a lot of that goes out with you taking responsibility, because we do have an onus on it. A lot of us have, when we're in a hole, a lot of us have people that can help us crawl out of that. Brené Brown, an amazing author and PhD, talks about the difference between empathy and pity. And empathy is those that will crawl down in the hole with somebody else to help them out, or just sit there in the hole. And pity is someone that stands at the top of the hole and says, man, that's really shitty. So some of us have that person, and they help us create what I was going into, emotiversity, the Mulligan brothers, some of these, you know, positive YouTube videos I was watching during this research, because I was getting kind of down. It was affecting me doing this research that I would watch. And a lot of that was, if you don't have somebody like that, someone to help you crawl out of those holes, and you got to start building that momentum on your own. And when you start to build that momentum on your own, it's something as simple as you start to make a plan for each one of your days. Like if you're somebody that has been, because of how the fucking system is working, you've been on unemployment forever. If you've been laid off temporarily or permanently because of these restrictions, and it's, you know, you had a good time for maybe the first week because it was like a couple weeks because it was like a paid vacation, but then you start to see that you don't know if there's an end in sight. And I'll go back to our gubernatorial debate last night. Jay Inslee was going to lift some restrictions a few weeks ago and then just didn't. And there's been no explanation as to why since then. That leaves a lot of people in fucking limbo. And you need to start kind of building that momentum on your own, because let's face the reality. We cannot and should not depend on anyone other than ourselves. Unless you're a child. It's just a fact. And if you're somebody that's trying to bring someone out of this hole, you can't just go in there and try to be a hype man and say everything's going to be okay, you're going to get through this. Because, again, facts and data say that a lot of times they're not going to get through this. A lot of times they're not going to make it. So you just need to be there for them. You need to just sit in silence if you need to and just talk with them and try to have a normal conversation. Not a conversation that perpetuates the hopelessness and shit of the situation that they may be sitting in. But it's just like as a combat medic in the Army, and you hear this go through doctors all the time. You never promise anybody anything, because you don't make promises you can't keep. And so as great as it is to like try to hype somebody up and be like, you're going to fucking make it. This, everything's going to be okay. You're going to get through this. A, you don't know that. B,
by saying they're going to get through this is denying the existence of people that won't. And the person that's sitting right in front of you might be one of those people. And that might be the thing that perpetuates their spiral downward. If everybody keeps telling them, oh, you're going to fucking make it, everything's going to be fine, and then things continue to get worse, that just creates a cascading effect. And I know it sounds great. I know it sounds great, hyping somebody up and shit like that. But if data means anything, the data that I've gotten over the research of the last week and a half points to the opposite of that. It's being real with people. It's getting down, like Brene Brown said, getting down in that hole with them and talking with them and empathizing with them and trying to find a connection of what might be going on in their life. Like I've got, like I've stated, I'm an essential employee. My life has changed very little except for the fact that I can't drink and I can't go out and get hammered like I used to and just like people watch and be a creep. So but I can sit and talk with somebody on the other side of the world, which I have friends in other countries who are going through a lot worse, some massive restrictions, and have them say like, oh, I can't work, or I can't do this thing or that thing. And I can sit there and they can tell me these things and I can say back to them like, oh, like, do you think that's affecting your self-worth? Do you feel like this or that adds to your worth, makes you more or less important because you're not working out in the open. Now you're working in the shadows, so to speak, from at home where nobody can see it and things like that. And people can't see how significant you are. Like it's empathizing so you can have those conversations. And that's what's going to bring us out of this, guys. I went over a book that I read a year ago for a podcast Luke and I were doing before Chris came on board, and it was called Enlightenment Now by Steven Pinker. And it's obviously on the Enlightenment and things that have happened since then and how we're doing better than we give ourselves credit for. Generally, that is the case. But if you're sitting around and you're not bathing, that's your first step. Is getting in, taking a bath or a shower, and taking care of your personal hygiene. Because that's the first thing that goes when you start to hate yourself. Enlightenment now goes into using data and reason for building our way of beliefs, but also humanism and making an effort to understand each other. And that lack of trying to understand each other was a plague in itself before COVID came. And COVID just pumped a bunch of steroids into it. So if you can, be aware of your surroundings. Don't be intrusive. Be tactful about it. But if you see people that you think are struggling or you think might be the bridge. Because it's tough to ask for help. A lot of people would just assume starve to death, be broke, go into debt, other things that will just perpetuate a self-hatred or depression before they ask for anything. Because it makes people feel less. It makes people feel like shit. So be that bridge to help them. To give them the strength so when they're in trouble next time, they can ask for help. Don't make them feel like shit for asking for it. Don't make them owe you anything. And don't do it because you expect anything. Do it because we need you to do it. They need you to do it.
This country needs you to do it. The world needs you to do that.
If I may?
Mm-hmm.
Not that we just went down one path, but on that same, to follow what you're saying, same thing if you believe someone is being hurt at home, you know, domestically by a life partner, whoever that person may be, male, female, whatever, you know, if you suspect anything, you know, say something. Mm-hmm. If you don't want to do it directly, you know, do it anonymously.
Mm-hmm.
Get it out there. Let them know that there's things they can do to keep themselves safe. Mm-hmm. That they don't have to be in a position where they feel like, well, I'm stuck in this. I must have done something that I deserve this now.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So, just on the same thing. Just, you know.
And that's a great thing you can. Bringing up. And a lot... when you tell somebody you can help them or you want to help them, a big thing is trust. So it's tough for them to trust people. It's tough for anybody to trust anybody. Oh. So be a person of integrity and be a person that is what's the word I'm looking for? Worthy of trust.
I still don't trust Luke.
In straight up. In certain aspects, you don't trust Luke.
Straight up.
Well, he's like, it's in certain situations.
No, okay. You don't justify it. I don't blame him.
In all fairness, he deserves it. And he knows
I do.
It.
I can't argue.
Yes.
Should never trust me.
But no.
The shit I will get you into.
Not to give the point too much levity. No. Like you were saying, be worthy. Be honorable.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
If you're not, your friends will call you out on your podcast.
So. Yeah, don't like if a woman's in trouble, don't try to help her to get sex.
Don't be the white.
If
knight.
A fuck it, yeah, don't be the nice don't guy. Don't be the creep. We talked
please.
About. If there's someone that's in a compromised situation, don't help them. Don't like give them money and want like 50% interest back or something. Or just
a favor back. You know. Just
yeah,
help.
Just fucking just help.
And if you can't help, direct them to someone or something that can help.
Direct them to help or just sit there. Just sit, like I said, just sometimes if you just sit in silence with somebody. And it's like, I remember when I was in finance and sales as a young man, and they would always say the first person that talks loses. And as far as like negotiating a deal. And so you just sit in silence.
How did you deal with that?
There were some awkward situations where you presented a deal to somebody and then you just sit there and you would stare at each other, look down at this paper that I had that was blank sitting in front of me that looked like it had stuff on it. And there that actual had all the stuff. And you just sit there, boom, look up. And you're just sitting there like, don't say anything. Don't say anything. And then you just wait. And that's how it is when you're talking with somebody that's going through some shit. Or, you know, I don't know. If you're in a relationship and fighting with your girl or your boyfriend or something like that, just these people don't necessarily need you to fix anything in their lives. They just need to have the belief reaffirmed that there is somebody that will listen to their struggle.
They need a presence.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. So just be. We usually say, "Don't be that guy." In quotes, be that guy. Be that girl.
Be the presence.
Be the presence. Thank you. That's it.
I have a little bit left. You sure you don't have anything else to say?